to get you, our audience, to think about ways that you can begin to live up to your full potential. If you see something, say something on the Not On My Watch show every Wednesday at 11 a.m. with me, Dr. Bruce.
Okay. With God's name, the merciful benefactor, the merciful redeemer, all the praise of gratitude belongs to the one, the only one who creates life, sustains that life, gives that life, all life, everything it needs to grow and become what it is destined to become. And that life includes you. And we pray for the prayers and the peace, the one who extends that life, the source of life that extends the prayers and the peace, the best comprehensive peace upon the messenger who's worthy of praise, who taught humanity how to pull out the excellence. And we pray for that peace upon all of the messengers, the prophets, who are examples of human life, human excellence, in values and principles and in behavior that demonstrate those values. And we pray for peace upon you, dear learner, who have tuned into this program. Welcome. I am Dr. Z, greeting you in light, love, peace, and harmony. So tonight, not sure exactly what's going to happen tonight. I've been so busy these last few days and weeks, and I guess I would have to say that, you know, I have life more abundantly. I think that's what we all want. So, you know, people ask you. So I'm just going to, whatever I'm given tonight, that's what we're going to do. But I want to look at our daily experiences and see how does this happiness campaign, this process of reading, writing affirmations, positive affirmations of value and behaviors, how does that, you know, show up every day? What is the practical application of what we're teaching? I mean, we've been now on this program, you know, once a week for several months, I think since June. And, you know, I really like interaction. I really like to know what kind of questions you all have and what kind of things are happening in your life so we can see how we can help. But in lieu of that tonight, I think I'll just kind of share some experiences that I'm having, share some experiences that some of the students who are taking the Keys to Everyday Happiness class with us on Tuesday evenings, we've been at it for next week will be the seventh and last class of this particular session. And so I think that's what we'll do tonight, just kind of look at our life experience. What is the value of what it is that we're offering and how does it show up? Not just for me, but for others as well. And really want to take a look at, I'm actually preparing for a talk on Friday, and I was doing some research, and so maybe we'll get a chance to share a couple of ideas from it. It's still a work in progress, but maybe there's something here we can share because we're really focusing on our speech. You know, so I was over the weekend, I was in Kansas City, Missouri, at a conference, and the conference is called A Time to Be Grateful. And it is definitely a time to be grateful. We had a wonderful time seeing some of our friends from around the country, and we had an opportunity unexpectedly to give a brief talk in the morning after our prayer time. And there maybe was, I don't know, 25, 30 people there. The person who was supposed to give it wasn't, you know, he had to leave early to follow the previous night, and then they asked me to do it, which I did. We talked about three types of people. You know, of course, that number one type that leads to happiness is the grateful person. So it was kind of interesting that the way God put it together, you know, I gave a talk about gratitude at the conference that was a time to be grateful, you know. but it's like when you get on this path that we're on, you know, I mean, get on it all the way where you are allowing yourself to go into the book, 25 Days of Living Your Happiness. You know, you can get it at drzhappiness.com. And actually, it's on sale this month because of holiday season. We've taken 20% off the regular price of $25 plus the shipping, and it's $20 plus the shipping. And so we, you know, encourage you, if you've been listening and you like what you like the vibes, the vibration, we encourage you to get the book. As a matter of fact, this is the gift-giving season. What do you think about getting the book and giving it? Give the gift of happiness to someone. Now, there's energy in the book, but it's not going to be realized unless you do what's in the book, follow the instructions. And once you do it and get on it, life really becomes different. It's like an amazing thing, Rod, that people are experiencing, those that's in the class. Last night we had the sixth class, and actually at the class number four, we start talking about gratitude. I think I was in here a couple of weeks after that, and we had a really high vibration session in here on the heels of that class on gratitude. But it's interesting because each week I see how they're evolving because they're allowing themselves to actually do the book. In fact, I played a couple of comments from some of the students maybe a couple of weeks ago. So what we've seen is not only have they begun to, you know, have that good feeling, but they're beginning to be able to kind of look in their environment and analyze and see which one of those energies are showing up within themselves first, as well as within in other people. You know, so you can, as you practice anything, you're going to get better. It's going to be easier to see. And so they're, you know, they're talking about how, you know, they're seeing within themselves, you know, that disease ego pop up where maybe before they weren't aware, you know, but now they're able to see it and kind of arrest it, you know, have some self-control so that they can feel better. And I encourage them this week to practice looking and seeing what shows up when other people, you know, are around you or what the situation is. Because, you know, the real secret, and I'm telling you all this, this is just for you all, it's a secret of life. But, you know, don't tell anybody. Of course, we're on a worldwide network, right? But I just for you that's listening or watching, this is the secret for you, okay? And that is that God can manage your life much better than you can. You know, the secret is that there's a spiritual world that's operating, that's bigger than this physical world, that's stronger than this, more powerful than this physical world that we see, you know. And once you allow yourself to really put yourself in the spiritual life, for real, not lip service and faking it. You know, we talk about life and spirit and God and all these things, but, you know, it can be a lip service if it's not down in our heart. You know, and that obedience and gratitude is something that we're living every day. That's what makes the difference. And once you put yourself in that energy consistently, deliberately, consciously, then everything in this spiritual world is going to respond to you. It's going to bring you opportunities. It's going to bring you people. It's going to bring you books, all kind of answers, all kind of vehicles to answer the questions that you're asking. You know, I wanted to spread this bigger, so I went on YouTube. And I did 25 tips, Dr. Z's 25 tips on YouTube. I made a commitment, and I put myself out there. I said, I'm going to do this for the first 25 days of November. And, you know, once you decide you're going to do something, you put yourself out there, you got to keep your word because that's the only way you're going to feel good, right? And there's some tough moments, but I did it. So, If you haven't tuned into that, then I'm going to encourage you to go on YouTube and just put Dr. Z Happiness in. DRZ Happiness. You know, think about the questions you're asking and then look and see, and know all of those tips are going to be on the side. Pick one or two that you think gives you some energy or that may appeal to what it is that you're looking for right now, what questions that you have. I'm convinced there's something in there. You know, I have my barber. I went to the barber shop today, got a nice haircut, you know, looking fresh, my fresh look. And I remember a few weeks ago, my barber was kind of distraught, you know. And again, we're on the topic tonight of, you know, how does this happiness, this peace that we want, you know, how does it work every day in our lives? So a few weeks ago, I was, you know, was there, maybe 3 weeks ago, and he was really distraught because something had happened with his the woman who he's with. I don't know if they're married or not. It doesn't matter. But, you know, she was going in a different direction. So, you know, he was way into the pain of that process. And, you know, I wanted to help him. So I was showing him the chart. You know, I asked him, where are you on this contrasting energies chart? He picked sorrow, pain. He was way down in the weeds of negative disease ego. And I invited him, you know, to get in touch with me. I invited him to the program, to the book. He didn't go, but he, you know, he did seek some help when I saw him a few weeks ago. So actually, I guess the first time was maybe 6 weeks ago, and I saw him 3 weeks ago. And what I did give him, I did put him on my email list 3 weeks ago, and he started getting my emails, right? Because if you're not on the list and you're listening to this, come on, what? You know, you're wasting your time. Just come on. Come on the train. Come on, we moving, right? You know you want to be here. That's why you're listening. You know you want to be here. That's why you tuned on to it on YouTube. So stop stealing from yourself and just come on. Anyway, so I saw him today. And his whole vibration is totally changed. You know, I left there calling him the joyful barber. I mean, his energy was high. He was... Woo, I was like, wow, what happened? And some things happen, you know. And he's a faithful person. He's a person who has, you know, he believes in God. And I can't really claim anything, but one thing he told me, it made me feel good. He said, yeah, I went on and I watched some of those things that you put out. Man, that stuff you putting out, that's really good, you know. And he has some things to say about it. Now, I really, really, you know, I can't take any credit for anything. But as a part of me, and maybe it's my diseased ego rolling, it wants to say, when he tuned into what we were putting out there, something happened in him. You know, I believe that's possible. Maybe it is not true, but I believe it's possible. So that's enough for me, because I know the power of this. You know, and so we, you know, we get these kind of messages, and I just feel encouraged to keep doing the thing, doing what we're doing. You know, Kansas City was like that too, because I met people that I didn't even know were tuning into the show. I didn't even know were checking out things on YouTube. You know, so you know, we're ending the year. This is a good time to brace up your inner self. I can't think of any better way than getting our book and practicing it. Now, last time we were here, we were talking about maybe having a class on the show starting in January. And it's still on the table, you know. It's something that we could do for maybe 6-7 weeks. But it will require that you get the book. And you can get an ebook. You don't want to spend $20 on yourself. If you don't value yourself enough to spend $20, $25 to change your life, I can't want it for you more than you want it for yourself. But if you don't have $20 but you want to get the ebook, just go to the website. The ebook's $9.99, and, you know, you can still participate. So... So, yeah, I'm really curious what's happening in your life. How can I help you tonight if you have a question or you have something you have been asking about and you're looking for an answer? Call in. 240-455-5934. That's 240-455-5934. This is your time. This is your class. This is your hour. So one of the things that we recognized is that words are so powerful. If we want to remake our world, if you want to remake your world, you got to remake the words that you're using. And I think one of these sessions we talked about, a good word is like a good tree, you know, and its roots go down into the ground and its branches go up into the sky. And, you know, the metaphor, it's a metaphor. And we talked about the metaphor of a bad word is like a bad tree that doesn't have any roots. It has no stability. And it doesn't produce any fruit. So when you're living in this spiritual vibration, what I'm understanding is that we have to develop an attitude where we learn how to really trust the spiritual power, trust the ultimate spirit, which is the creator, and recognize that that spirit is breathed into everything that's alive. And that spirit works in you, it works through you, and it works for you and everything else in creation. So that when you're on this path for real, and then you will see things show up if you're asking is with clarity and you're aligning your vibration up with what you want and you're allowing yourself to receive what you want through action. You know, on the YouTube, those are three separate tips that we have. Go check them out. You know, aligning your vibration, asking with clarity, aligning your vibration, and allowing yourself to receive. And so things are just going to kind of show up, as opposed to, you know, the competition, the Z's Eagles always trying to make something happen. Let me force something happen. Let me dominate. Let me exert my will on other people and make. That's not the way that life is supposed to be if we want abundance. And abundance is here. We can't just look at the appearances and think that that's the reality. It can be our reality if that's all that we are looking at. But when you join the spiritual path that we're on, you will learn how to see more than what you're looking at. And that's where we want to be. And things will just come to you, like that opportunity to speak. You know, they made a CD. The guy recorded it and gave me some CDs. So now, not only are we able to help the people that were there, but we're able to help other people that weren't there. You know, because it was already planned by the Creator that I would be sharing some ideas, even though I had no clue, no idea that it was going to happen. So part of this journey is, you know, first is getting the foundation so that you're in it. It becomes a habit, a way of thinking, a way of feeling, a way of being. And then you have to look for the signs that show up in your life, you know, because they're going to show up. They have to read the signs properly. You know, one of the tips I gave was actually called Reading the Signs. So on YouTube, I was telling a story. I was trying to, you know how when you want to do something and you get your mind set on doing it, right? And that's really all you're thinking about. It's like a horse with blinders on. But sometimes the situation and the energy in the situation is such that you're not going to be able to do what you want to do because you're trying to force the issue. And in the spiritual life, there's really no force. You don't have to force anything, you know. So I was, you know, intent on doing these tips because I had gotten into this rhythm. And I wanted to make sure that I had a tip up every day to keep my word for 25 days in a row in November, which is the month of giving. This was my task for giving to show gratitude for being alive and for the gift that I have. You know, think about that for yourself for tomorrow, for this week. What can you give to show gratitude for the life that you have? You got something to give, even if all you have to give is a kind word and a smile as a charity. That's good, you know. Or lift somebody's bag up for them. Or open the door for somebody as an action of gratitude. So as you learn how to just pay attention to the signs. So I wanted to do these, you know, these tips, two tips. I was at George Mason University. I wanted to do the two tips that day. But then there were people, and I went outside, and there were people over there, I don't know, 20 yards from me. They were talking real loud, so I couldn't turn on my computer or use my phone to record anything because I would have had that background noise. So I said, I'm going to wait. Instead of being frustrated, I said, I'm going to be patient and just wait. And I waited and I waited and waited. And then, hey, it didn't happen. Then they kept, because the third person showed up, so there was more people talking loud. And then the students started coming out. It must have been a break between classes because students were coming from everywhere. And they were walking back and forth in front of me from both sides. And it was noise to me. But I didn't recognize the energy. I couldn't, you know, because I had my mind set, I'm going to do these things. I'm gonna do it now. So I went over partway out of the away from the noise and the movement. And I did two videos on my phone. So when I got back to check, neither one of them came through because the technology didn't work. They were both blank. So, you know, I put all my energy into that and I'm going to press it. I'm going to do this. And finally, you know, I was anxious. I was in my diseased ego, even though I didn't see it. Because I wasn't paying attention to the energy around me. So once I went back inside, I saw I didn't have anything. Then I stopped and I got silent and still. And then it dawned on me, Rod, that the lesson was sometimes things are not going to be the way you want it to be and the timing is not right, you know. And you have to read the signs of the energy in the situation because it was all noise and movement. And the opposite energy of noise and movement is silence and stillness, right? But I couldn't see it because I had made my mind up what I was going to do. So once I changed my vibration, I read the signs, changed my vibration from the noise and the movement into silence and stillness, my whole vibration changed. So we ended up going home, and it was pretty close to, almost close to sunset. So I went in my yard and I recorded the video, the tip, read the signs, which is what I was supposed to record anyway. But I had to allow myself to see the lesson, right? And to respond to it. And so, you know, that's a tip for you right now. That's an everyday thing. Pay attention to the vibrations and the energy that's within you and around you every moment. And if it's feeling positive, then you want to keep moving with that. But if it's feeling negative, you have to identify where on the scale is the energy. You know, that's how you use the tool. You got to get the tool so you can learn how to use it. But the more you use it, the more proficient you're going to be, the better your life's going to be, the greater your faith's going to be. You know, faith, obedience, gratitude, you know, that's how we have to do our action, and purposeful, you know, with the purpose that we're going to accomplish what it is. And I know people say, like I was talking to the joyful barber, that's what I'm going to call it from now on. I hope you're listening, man, you know, or watching, because we had a really good time today. You know, your joy lifted my spirit up, and that's how we want to be with each other, isn't it? You know, who wants to be around a drag, somebody always complaining and blaming and get the violin out, you know, sad story. That's not the life you were born to live. You weren't born to live in difficulty. You know, there's a certain ease about life. but we got to learn how to get there. And that's all we're trying to do is help. So, what's on your mind? Give us a call, 240-455-5934. You know, we got the holiday season coming up. Things are going to shift. They're going to shift upward because people will be in the spirit of giving and joy, right? Merriment. You know, go and spend time with your family. You know, doing more of your religious worship and practice. You know, this is a heightened time of year. We should all be serious about that in our preparation for next year. And it's going to start with the words, with the good words. So I don't know. What do you have for us? I don't know. Rod Roland, you got anything? What's been happening? What kind of things are showing up?
Well, I can tell you this much. There's a lot of anxiety about the coming year and the new administration. There's a lot of anxiety building, and I'm hearing from folks in terms of relationships that we're having with one another, especially male and female. And then on the positive side, I'm hearing a lot of folks are saying that we may be in a situation where the changes that are happening in 2017 may benefit us individually and as a collective, especially among people who look like us. But in reference to, in the context of what you're teaching, and with some of your students, have they been expressing the same kind of sentiment, the same kind of anxieties, and the same kind of concerns about moving forward in the future with new administration or in their relationships?
No.
And I'm curious because almost everyone I talk to.
Yeah.
So what is amiss?
Well, this is interesting because this is going to help us tie into what I'm trying to prepare for this talk on Friday.
Okay.
All right. I got a reflection I'm working on. It's not all the way there yet, but it's relevant. So I think the first thing, and you know, when I start the show, and when I start my speaking and when I start my writing nowadays, right? And I'm on this program to complete another book. It's going to be called Keys to Everyday Happiness. It's going to take us to another level. I always make this prayer. So I'm giving y'all the inside of Dr. Z and his approach. And the prayer is, oh God, please remove from me all personal wants and desires and fill me with your desire, what you want for your people. So that when I speak and I write, they do not hear of me or anything of me or my knowledge or my will. They hear of you and your will, your desire, your knowledge, your wisdom, and what you want for them. Amen. That's my prayer. Before I start this program, before I speak anywhere, and before I do my writing in the morning. And I find once I say that, everything, once I use those words, right? Everything then is perfect. Because I'm just a conduit, a vessel to be used by the Creator. And you are too. I'm saying this is saying it ain't about me. You're the same way. But it's a matter of what choice we want to make about which direction we want our energy to go in. So those who have this anxiety about the future, that's a choice. You can't control the future. Most of the time, the fear that we have is false evidence appearing real. Fear. We have anxiety because of fear, right? But those who are God conscious, those who are on this path of gratitude we're talking about, they have no fear and they have no grief. So I have to check myself. When I start getting fearful, I have to check myself. In this moment, am I choosing to be grateful? Or am I choosing some language from a different direction? And where is that language coming from? That's got me anxious and fearful, right? Because the future, the thing about fear is there's two qualities. One is it's something that hasn't happened yet. It's future-oriented. What we fear, right? It's not in the present moment. It's future-oriented. It hasn't happened yet. And the second part about fear is that we make it up in our mind. You know? There really is no fear unless we choose to be fearful. So how silly is it for a human being who is the crown of creation, who has this faculty of thinking and rational intelligence that puts him above everything else in creation? How silly is it for us to be fearing something that we made up in our mind that hasn't even happened yet? And what we need to understand is that by putting out that vibration of fear, we're going to attract more things to fear, be fearful of. By putting out anxiety and worry and doubt, what? The Creator still is not in charge? Where is our faith? And everybody, all the churches, all the mosques been giving this, you know, faith sermon since the election, right? You know. But for real, what do we need to be anxious about if we are really conscious that God is in charge of everything of our lives? Then we really, you know, and because of that consciousness, we want to be obedient. We want to be grateful, even for the president-elect, for everything, right? Then that's going to shift the vibration. If we could get everybody that is fearful to change their vibration and move into that love energy we're talking about, things would shift. Now, we're just talking concept right now.
Okay.
Right? We got to find what's the practical application of it. Okay. You know, what does it really mean? And even more so than that, let's think about where does it come from? Where's the origin of these words that we're choosing to think and feel? You know, words are really important because words, the thoughts that we have and the words that we choose have a direct link to our belief system, what we believe is going to be, right? And if it's in a negative direction, then we're going to have negative beliefs about it. Mm-hmm. Same for the positive, right?
Right.
Now, what we believe is going to impact our imagination. We're going to start thinking of pictures to match the words, thoughts, and beliefs that we have, right? Those images and pictures are powerful because we, you know, our souls latch on to that. Our hearts and our mind latch onto those pictures, and it affects how we feel. And our emotions and feelings, that's where our power is. That's where our energy is and how we feel. Does this make any sense so far? And the feelings are going to drive the behaviors. So, for example, you know, we saw on YouTube talk about the anxiety and the fear, right? Where a group of young folks, guys in his car, I don't know where it was in the country, you might have seen it, white guys in his car, and we got these young black kids, and they pull a car, the guy out the car, and they beat him up.
Right.
Right? You know, he voted Trump. Anxiety. Fear. Now, that is a example of behaviors, negative behaviors that's coming from this negative feeling, that's coming from whatever imaginational pictures they have and their belief systems about themselves and white people and the words that they use, right? So I'm going backwards. But, you know, that's a choice. So now when we do stuff like that, we're actually fulfilling the fear that white people have about black people. Hell, not only white people have it about we have fear about our own self. We've been conditioned by the society, right, to see ourselves less than the value that God has put on us as honorable people. Where does all this stuff come from? Is it in our nature to be anxious? When the baby is born, is he anxious? In the first couple of years of our lives, are we anxious or are we in this happiness and peace, this, right? You know, the pattern is here. We just have to learn how to look at it. So here's this thing that we've been, I don't know, let me let you respond before I get into to this reflection.
Well, the first thing is something stuck in my mind, and you said that fear is associated with something that has not even happened yet. So what I think of is that I'm going to walk into a situation, I'm going to inherit a situation, whatever it is, mm-hmm. that I'm not going to be able to handle.
Mm-hmm.
So in essence, if I'm making a move or something is happening, mm-hmm. and like the weather, you know, when I was growing up, I was powerfully afraid of thunderstorms.
Mm-hmm.
And my concern was as the dark clouds came that we were going to be presented with something that I couldn't handle. You know, the wind, the lightning, something, mm-hmm. that it was going to do something to my home, do something to, that it had the potential to do these things. And that if something were to happen, I wouldn't be able to handle it. I wouldn't be able to survive it,
mm-hmm.
right?
Mm-hmm.
It would adversely affect my family, my neighborhood, et cetera. So when I saw the dark clouds come in, I would get very nervous.
Mm-hmm.
And then the darker they became, I became fearful,
mm-hmm.
because I didn't know what it was going to unleash.
Mm-hmm.
But I did know that if the fury was strong enough, I wouldn't be able to handle it. Or I believed that I wouldn't
be able to handle it. You believed that was a choice. And you had
things in mind. So you're saying I made the choice to believe that I couldn't handle it?
Well, I'm saying yes, but it's not a fault or a blame. Because
I'm just asking.
When I was growing up, when it was a thunderstorm, you had to turn all the lights out, right? That was the practice in the house. You had to turn the lights out and sit down,
mm-hmm.
for fear,
mm-hmm.
of this storm.
Mm-hmm.
So that's the same
right.
thing you're talking about, right?
You couldn't talk. You,
yeah, you did. That was it.
I actually was in a situation, my grandmother's house, where lightning came through,
mm-hmm.
the front door.
Mm-hmm.
The screen door was open, came mm-hmm. through the screen door, and circled in the living room.
Mm-hmm.
And made its way out the back door.
Yeah.
And she said, thank God we had that back door open as well. Because if it had not, that lightning had no place to escape.
Mm-hmm.
And it would have exploded inside. I physically saw the lightning circle.
Right
in front of me.
Yeah. So that's out of your control.
Understood.
And that kind of experience would traumatize anyone to be afraid of that happening again or something, right?
Right.
Okay. Now, the question...
But no, you know what? I'm wrong.
Go ahead.
I'd never been afraid of that since. That didn't... Lightning coming through the door and not having a place to escape,
mm-hmm.
didn't cross my mind a whole lot when there was a thunderstorm. It really didn't.
So where did it come from that you had this fear of thunderstorms?
I saw something on TV and a tornado hit something and mangled it.
Okay.
And that started it.
Okay. So, but here's the thing. Regardless of the stimulus.
Okay.
At a certain point, a choice was made.
Okay.
And these things can be conditioned from our experiences. Because the question we're asking is, where does all this negativity come from? Right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So you think about the words that we use. So I'm doing this research, right? And I'm looking up some stuff in the guidance. And it's an order that's given to the prophet to say to my servants, this is going to be rough. The Friday we'll have it all together. So there's a command. All of the prophets of God and messengers of God lived out the commands that God wants human beings to live, correct?
Right.
That's a basic assumption. And so if we're saying, God is saying, to say to my servants, to let them speak that which is more excellent. So the idea here is to inform us the model of human excellence, any model of human excellence, to inform us that the human beings, the servants of God, for them to speak and say things which are more excellent. So when you have a situation, you want to put the best construction on it. Right?
Right.
I mean, we're talking about the political situation, the government. Is anxiety a words or speech of excellence? What people are saying from their anxiety, is it speech of excellence? No, I don't think so, generally speaking. And then it goes on to say that the enemy, I don't even like to say the enemy's name, but for sure, there is an enemy to the human beings who are slaves of God and obedient to God. There's an enemy. Now, the enemy has no power except to call you. Right? And when the deal goes down and you and the enemy and maybe in your ass, you're going to say, hey, look, I didn't have no power over them. All I did was call them. They came. Can't blame me. You got to look at yourself. That's the reality. So this enemy, it's a fact that this enemy, that his deal is to create this mischief, right?
Right.
That this corruption and this perversion, he causes it. When we're not saying words that are better, that are excellent, right?
Right.
Then the words that we're saying are coming from the enemy, and he's causing this disruption, this distortion, this perversion in our own thinking, and he's causing this recklessness in our own soul, which is, and this is a recklessness between the people, between the servants. I mean, if you just think about it, right? When we have relationship issues, is that language excellent language, the best construction on it, or is it negative language? Probably it's going to be negative.
Right.
The conversations that we have, the arguments we have, we're still supposed to speak excellent. If we're not doing that, then we're being influenced by the enemy. And it's causing harm in the relationships, right? Okay. That's pretty clear. Okay? And so, and then the understanding that the enemy was, in fact, it characterizes this as an enemy that is clear, that is visible, you know. But what he's really, as an enemy, he's contracting or bringing about hatred between people because he wants to harm us. He wants the wickedness because God promised the human being, right, this paradise, this great life. But the enemy's idea was that I'm better than him, right? You created me out of fire. You created him out of mud, dirt. I'm better. And God said, hey, bow down, prostrate to the man I made, to the original nature to be excellent. I'm not talking about a physical man. Well, you got it. When you read the scripture, you got to understand it's metaphors. I mean, it'd be talking about some physical man, Adam, being the original nature that God created for us to be obedient. We see Abraham living this idea of obedience out, right? And all of us that call ourselves by certain labels, Muslim, Jewish, Christian, we are part of the Abrahamic faith. All of the prophets throughout all of history come from the seed of Abraham, his line. Now, there's a split between Ishmael and Isaac. Fine. But there's still all of them are tracked back to Abraham. So there's something about Abraham and what Abraham represents for the human being to live the excellent life. And God took Abraham as a friend, right? So I'm studying up on Abraham. Maybe we'll have some, we'll talk. If we could have a real nice conversation, you do some study too. And I believe whatever holy book we're reading, we're going to come to the same thing in the middle in terms of universal value and symbol of Abraham for the human being, the best life. That obedience, right? When you get down to it. So it's a choice that we are making. And the enemy's whole thing, let me read this. I was looking at something else. It says, yes, to let the obedient slaves, and you know, we don't like the word slave because of our experience in America. But to be a slave of God, that's the best position you can be in. Because the master's going to take care of his slave in all respects, right? Because through the slave, the master's able to get done the work that he wants to get done. And each one of you as God's servant has a purpose, has a calling, has something that you're supposed to be delivering, to serve through devotional service and to make sacrifice in this life that you have. How long you think you're going to live? You ain't got forever. If you don't do it now, when is it going to get done? So say to my obedient slaves, I want to be God's slave. Because can't nobody take care of me like God can take care of me. Let them speak in their conversations and their arguments the good word and always articulate through the best words. That surely the Satan causes corruption, perversion, degradation, thoughtlessness and recklessness between people for the purpose of harming and injustice. He fans the flame, he fans the fire of temptation, discord, and makes these things attractive to us. Because misery loves company, right? And he does this with the crude words and causes a slip of the tongue by it. He tried to manifest the hatred of former times, searches for a decline in their language so people sink down, and provokes evil of hostility and hatred between a person and his brother. So we have to be careful what we're saying about this election, right? Because we either are using the best language that God gives us, or we are using the hatred, you know, that's been spurred up. I mean, some people are working for the devil. And you can tell in the language. They're talking language of hate. If their campaign is run on hate, I don't need to say no more, do I? Right? Then you have to see where that's coming from. And that's not our, refusing God is not our program. Because to refuse God is to be arrogant. And basically saying, I know better than God. How you going to know better than God? You don't know nothing. Just because you went to school don't mean you know anything. They ain't teaching you what you need to know in school. So that refusing God to submit to what God wants you to do leads to arrogance. That arrogance leads to ingratitude. And so being in this place of ingratitude and cast out, despised, created that from his attitude. That's not our program. Our program is to say yes to God. Our program is humility, and our program is gratitude. And when we put ourselves in that space and live this spiritual life that we're offering through this campaign, just go buy the book. Try it. $20 ain't going to kill you. Just try it. See what happens. And I promise you, if you do it and keep doing it and keep doing it, your life is going to be amazing, just like mine is. So I'm going to sign out. You know, people ask me, what's happening, Dr. Z? I used to say, life, love, and happiness. That's what I've been saying. Y'all hear me? Life, love, and happiness. Well, I'm adding something to it now. It's life, love, happiness, and abundance. Good God Almighty. Because we all are super bad. Thank you all very much. I won't be here next week. We're going to take a little break. But we'll be back. And if you're interested in joining the class in January, we can run a class on Wednesday night from 7 to 8 here on the show. But you need to sign up at the website, drzhappiness.com. Get your book, get your e-book. And come on, let's spread this love all over the world. Thank you. I thank you. God bless you. And we pray God accept this from us, for surely you are the one who hears and you are the knower. Amen. Amen. Thank you. Are we off now? No, we ain't off. We on. Come on, let's get on.
Watch me, watch me, I got it. Watch me, I got it. Hey, I got something that makes me wanna shout. I got something that tells me what it's all about. I got soul and I'm super bad. I got soul and I'm super bad. Tells me what to do. Sometimes it's easy. Now I got a move that tells me what to do. Sometimes I feel so nice, I wanna try myself a few. I got soul and I'm super bad. I love to do my thing, and I don't need no one else. So nice, good God, I jump back, I wanna kiss myself. I got soul and I'm super bad. Hey, I said I'm super bad.